So have you ever met a fighter pilot before? I haven't. How interesting. Missy was one of the first female fighter pilots.
That's correct.
What year did you start flying planes?
So that was in 1994.
1994. And now you're a professor.
That's correct.
And you said that you don't know how anybody can become a professor before they've been a fighter pilot.
That is correct. I left being a fighter pilot because, you know, being in that first group of women, it was tough. And the guys definitely did not want us. I've written a book about it. You can get that book for free online. I've made it free to everyone. I thought I was going to change my life for the positive, meaning I wanted to be in a positive environment. I wanted to teach young minds and give back to and do research about human-machine interaction because I saw so many people die when I was a fighter pilot. And then it has recently occurred to me that I left the Navy to get away from sexism and bias and gender discrimination, and I didn't. So it is just as well.
You wound up in
tech. Right. Well, not only am I in tech, but just in academia in general. I think the funny thing about academia is it's no better than being a fighter pilot. The guys are just smarter about hiding it.
You're not a cheerleader for this. You're quite skeptical about it. You think that you're not an Elon Musk fan. You're a little bit ahead. You think these people are a little bit ahead of where the reality of this is going. Talk to us about where you think the state of the art is, mm-hmm. how far this journey to full autonomy really is.
It is my day-to-day work is working in artificial intelligence and robotics. I'm a techno-realist. I love technology. I'm a roboticist. It's my job to be a futurist, to look into that crystal ball and see not only what's going to happen, but how to make sure that we guide the technology to be safe and efficient. But in the case of driverless cars, you know, I also happen to be on the board of directors for a tier one automotive supplier, joint U.S.-Swedish company, Veoneer. And so I have insight not only from the academic side, but from the business side. And it's just simply breathtaking how hype has pushed far, 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 far beyond what the technology is actually capable of, to the point that Uber did put their driverless car on the road and they did kill a pedestrian. And I testified in front of the Senate Commerce Committee years before that happened that that was going to happen. I know you just heard me say driverless cars aren't going to really happen anytime soon, but the counter to that is drones are. And drones are a much more mature technology, and we can have another offline discussion about why they are much more ready for prime time. In that realm, that is the right balance of human and automation is to have humans in a remote command center and let the drones actually do the job in the field. My job is to make sure that we get the right allocation, the right balance between humans and machines. We're not there in driverless cars. We're not there in healthcare systems, by the way. IBM Watson was a massive failure for any kind of diagnostic element. And so one of the things that I work on, for example, is how to bring the human in with the autonomy and the artificial intelligence to build a collaborative arrangement such that humans can really bring their creativity and judgment under uncertainty, whereas computers can do a lot of the grunt work and processing of massive amounts of data to the point that they can work together. Reality is somewhere, for most systems, it's somewhere in between.